currency impacts in the coffee market, just like every other agricultural commodity market that's dollar denominated. When you have a stronger U.S. dollar, the currency will be impacting the commodity in the sense that the commodity price has to go down to compensate for the increase in the dollar. So this is across the board, whether or not you're talking about corn, sugar, pork, cattle, anything. But in specific to coffee, we find that the relationship also is stronger with the Brazilian real, which means that if you have a weaker Brazilian real, you're actually having a more bearish coffee scenario. So stronger dollar, bearish commodities, weaker real, weaker coffee market. Beyond that, coffee is impacted by currency moves because of the cost of production. Everything else that's dollar denominated, including fuel and fertilizer, will be impacting how agricultural enterprises deal with their balance sheet, what they're buying and what they're selling. And so if you look at it on a longer term scale, the exchange rate also could impact how coffee and any agricultural commodity for that matter is traded. Where production grows, where production shrinks. With an idea that the increase of the price will inevitably generally lead to an increase in sales, if you distill that down to coffee, an increase in the dollar-denominated coffee means that Brazilian or any other coffee producers are actually receiving more money in their local currencies and therefore will sell. Now, it's difficult to divorce this from the actual price or differential associated with local coffee values. But what we can say generally is, of course, and this is very general, that when prices go up, many times people will sell. This chart to your right actually is the 24-month average exports out of Brazil. And juxtaposed there is the New York price in Brazilian reals. And so what we find is that spikes in the price in reals lead to an increase in exports. And it's noticeable that the decrease recently in exports as a longer-term average has come while the Brazilians have actually been sitting on quite a large supply of coffee. So they've been holding back coffee because the market has been moving against them. The market is New York as well as the currency situation. Also, there is a table from Procafe who talks about the impacts of currencies and coffee in importance to general economies. Now you can see in that far column a share of exports is value. Now Brazil exports quite a lot of products, so coffee represents only about 3% of total export value, meaning that the movement of coffee isn't going to be impacting the Brazilian real. There's just too weak of a relationship there. But if you look at some other currencies and markets, especially Ethiopia, for example, where 46% of export revenue is actually in coffee, in Guatemala, Nicaragua, Honduras, Rwanda, Burundi, these are all examples of very high level of coffee exports as share of revenue. And what that means is that it impacts policy moves. The dollar-denominated purchases of that nation means that the government generally wants to encourage exports and encourage production and shifts policy back that. And whether that be discouraging the storage of coffee when certain dollar-denominated things are needed to buy, or whether it is a country trying to produce more coffee by clearing land and producing more plantations. All of this is basically to increase coffee exports to increase the dollar revenue that they're able to make and therefore buy other dollar-denominated things, whether that be oil or other agricultural commodities. Generally, look, agricultural commodity sector is global. But when we talk about coffee currencies, we're talking about these main origins. Of course, Brazil, Central America, Colombia, the African origins, and the Asian origins. I mentioned earlier how some of the shares are very large. An interesting dynamic with Brazil is that the share of production of coffee, especially Arabica in Brazil, is so large that the Brazilian real is starting to impact the coffee market directly. And we'll talk about that a little bit more in a moment. Just an idea of what is shifting currencies. Nations that are requiring quite a lot of foreign direct investment to make up their capital balance sheets, and that can be a relatively fickle source of foreign currency, are generally more volatile than other currencies that have a little bit more of a base in domestic development. Some of the currencies I'm sort of focusing on there would be the Brazilian, the Indonesian, and the Indian. Another aspect of currency is the idea that producers sometimes are not willing to give up the agricultural commodity for their currency, potentially meaning that they're using the commodity as a hedge, a liquid asset that they can sell, no pun intended, that they can sell and buy and get currency from later, but they don't necessarily want to put the coffee into currency because they're worried about inflation or they're worried about the devaluing of the currency. Argentina at the moment is an example of that. Vietnam in the past has been an example of that, farmers holding coffee off of the market because they'd much rather have coffee instead of currency. Now, just to give you the scale of currency moves in the last couple of years, this is most of the coffee currencies normalized from the peak of the New York market in 2011. When we peaked at about $3.13 in May 2011, this is the move we have had since then for these currencies. And you can see that there's generally three outlying currencies that have been shifting quite significantly. At the bottom there is the Brazilian real, which has moved 47% since that peak. The Indian and Indonesian currencies are also second and third. And then you have a mid-tier there, including the Mexican, the Colombian, the Ethiopian, and the Nicaraguan currencies, who are shifting certainly somewhere more or in the teens. So an impact, of course, but not nearly the same kind of impact that we're seeing out of Brazil. This is an example of the volatility that we have seen. And it hasn't been all straight lines either. These are all of those currencies normalized to that one moment in 2011 when the New York price peaked. And you can notice that most of the moves have actually occurred in the last 12 months. So what is actually shifting this move, and I'm going to spend little as time about this as I possibly can, but essentially it's the U.S. market, the U.S. economy, the QE3 tapering, and the potential for investors to remove currency from emerging markets and bring them back to the United States. And that flight of capital is essentially shifting the value of the currencies, what we're seeing. And this is a major reason why we've seen the Brazilian, the Indian, and the Indonesian move quite significantly. Now, what does this mean in coffee, though? This first graph, the Bloomberg graph on your right, is the coffee price in New York normalized to that peak again, the top of prices in May 2011. And it's the normal price in US dollars, and it's the price in Brazilian reals. Now, you notice that the price, and it's until November, so the recent rally actually isn't there. The price In New York, in U.S. dollars, fell to about 35% of its value at the peak. But if you're actually looking at the price in reals, it fell to 51% of its value. So the spread is on the bottom there, which means that because of the devaluation of the real, there is a 15% benefit for producers there who had this tempered. Had the price in New York, the price correction lower, tempered by their shift in currency. Is that clear? Another example on the second graph is the Indonesian and the Indian currencies having moved quite significantly in the last year. Doing the same thing as far as New York is concerned, tempering the shift in prices. Now, if the market were to take this into account and try to shift and balance, you would expect then differentials to potentially shift in accordance to how the exchange rates are moving. But if we look at ICO data for the last couple of years, the differentials, which are on the right, haven't shifted to compensate for movements in currency. This is an important dynamic, because some areas of production then are at an advantageous stint in the marketplace simply based on their currency. An example of that is the right-hand graph. The other one was the left-hand graph. This is the Brazilian real and the Colombian peso, and the coffee prices in both of them, the New York coffee prices. And you can see that since the fall in 2011, there's been above a 20% differential between how the local price in coffee is relative in Colombia to Brazil. Now, everything, this is all in a vacuum, so you have to take into account that differentials have changed, New York has changed, there are subsidies to be involved, the final price of coffee is very different, but it's being influenced by the FX, certainly. And what we find here is that there are some winners and there's some not winners, in the sense that they're not the advantage isn't quite there as far as currency goes. So let's look at the situation between the real and the coffee market a little bit closer. So what we find is that the relationship is actually getting somewhat stronger. A function of this is the relationship between how much Arabica Brazil produces. If you look at a long-term chart, the share of Arabica production was very high, dropped off a little bit a couple of decades ago, and has now started to increase again. The liberalization of currency moves, as well as the liberalization of coffee without the quota or anything like that, has also made those ties somewhat stronger. And of course, last year was the first year that you could actually deliver Brazilian beans to the New York Exchange, which has also probably impacted that relationship somewhat as well. This is a quote from one of our FX researchers. And this is just a very quick look at what they're looking at for the Brazilian market. U.S. Fed tapering and concerns about Chinese growth outlook may continue to erode global commodity prices and undermine capital flows in the emerging markets like Brazil. Brazil is now bumping up against supply constraints, as evident from its worsening external accounts and its stubbornly above target inflation. Brazil's growth inflation trade-off is worsening. I don't want to harp on the economic situation in Brazil, but what I want to say is that the Brazilian economy is impacting its currency, and its currency is impacting then the coffee market. It's actually tempering the effect of what the New York price is doing in local value. This is just the Brazilian real, US dollar cross, and the price of coffee. And I'm going to talk about correlation a little bit in a second, but there is a relationship there one can see, I think. If you look at the green line, which is the coffee price, the Arabica price, in the 2002 coffee crisis when we bottomed out at around 26, around 40 cents, you notice that the Brazilian U.S. dollar cross also peaked at this area. And then when the dollar Brazilian relationship started to move lower, when the Brazilian currency started to evaluate, we see that the actual New York market starts to move up. Again, I'm not going to say that the coffee price is a function of the exchange rate, but I'm saying that it's influencing it, and its influences can be seen. If you look at the core, and these are reasons why, this is the share of Brazilian Arabica production, which grows, that's the green. And with that, of course, exports. Everybody knows that the Brazilian domestic consumption grows very strongly, but their exports are also growing very strongly. The correlation, I don't really want to go too much into the modeling of the correlation between the two, but what we find is that, of course, there is a positive correlation, and then it's been growing stronger in the last 15 years. If you look at the R squared for the last 4 years, for example, an 89 isn't actually bad. So we actually think that this relationship is getting stronger and is something that one can look towards to try to forecast prices. So if you're forecasting the coffee price moving the next year, the next 2 years, you also have to take into mind what the Brazilian currency is going to be doing as well. Now, let's look at that currency and movement in the last couple of years again. This is, again, the normalized price from the peak in 2011 in Brazilian reais and U.S. dollar. And what we see is, of course, it's rebounded. The Brazilian price in Brazilian currency is the high line, and the U.S. dollar is the low line. And what we find is that this recent rally, and of course, this isn't even including yesterday's rally, means that the Brazilians in terms of currency for their own for the New York price, are receiving around 91% of what we had at the peak in 2011. So there's one way to look at this down correction lower from 2011 till around November. One way is to say the coffee prices were falling because the Arabica surplus was building and the Arabica demand wasn't growing because the arbitrage got high, everybody switched into Robusta, and that made a relatively bearish Arabica market story. But at the same time, the Brazilian real was devaluing, meaning that the influences of New York, the influences of New York were being felt less. So the market in New York had to compensate for the currency shift itself. And I think that that's very important. Excuse me. I mentioned earlier the cost of production. Generally, what we find is that when farmers are buying fertilizer and pesticide, they have to buy it in dollar-denominated amounts. Also, other things that they purchase, because generally a currency that's devaluing can impact inflation. But it's difficult to actually find a correlation between the cost of production and the exchange rate, simply because most of the cost of production in Brazil and in many other areas is labor. And labor is set by policy. And labor goes up in Brazil the last couple of years, certainly, and has been a major function of why the cost of production of coffee has gone up. Also, in Brazil, the cost of fuel is a set price by the government. And in many other countries, the fertilizer and fuel may be subsidized, or there may be caps on prices. It's difficult to sort of generalize on this, and what we find is that that correlation isn't quite there. So what can we say about the production of Brazilian coffee and the real? We can say that the production of Brazilian coffee is a function of the price, and that's very clear. But of course, it's delayed. There's gaps. The amount of time it takes to plant the coffee and actually harvest it are a couple of years. So you'll notice that in 2002, when we had this very large Brazilian crop, that was a function, of course, of the 1997 or the 1999 rally. And in this situation, though, the currencies were going along with it. And I think that that's important, because the currencies can be that final influential factor. So from our outlook, we expect a fairly bearish outlook for the Brazilian real. We have modestly weaker forecasts for the other currencies, but it is the real in particular that we are focusing on. And that is our numbers now, actually an 18% devaluation by the time we get to Q4 2015. So we're looking at a 2.75 USD exchange rate, which is pretty significant move from where we are. But we've already had a pretty significant move in the last couple of years. Again, this is all much of it predicated on the industry, the currency, the economy itself in Brazil, as well as the United States. For the Colombian peso, 11%, which means that the gap between them, the 17%, is again an advantage to Brazilian producers, all else being equal. And so, as for an outlook, I want to take a step back. If you look at these two price sequences, the green price is the New York price on a quarterly average from 1997 to 2002. 1997 to 2002 was essentially a rally that was predicated on much of the industry being short and a little bit of labor dispute and some weather problems, resulting in a very high New York market, and then a shift lower. So low, in fact, we basically were a bear market until 2002, when coffee prices bottomed out in the coffee crisis. But there was a moment in 1999 when we rallied on some weather concerns. In fact, rallied quite significantly. And that is that little sharp green jump there, when we went from about $1 to $1.70 over about 2.5 months. And the market is actually exhibiting a very similar move at the moment. And I'm not going to say that this potentially means that there's going to be some downside, but I think it's been talked about a little bit and alluded to a little bit today. But there's a very structural the large potential latent supply of Arabica in the market. And while there is a supply disruption at the moment because of weather, if that structural supply is allowed to continue, one has to wonder about the demand prospects of Arabica. And if you look at 2009 to 2014, which is the blue line, which is what we're currently on now, we're on this ascent going up. And I think that moving forward, one of the things we're certainly going to have to look at is the currency. This is that similar chart. The blue line is still the 1997 to 2002 line. So the peak there to the left there is the 1999 rally. And then we went all the way down to 2002. And the green line is actually the USD-Brazilian cross again. And it was a major devaluation of the Brazilian real, which meant that the impact of the lower prices in New York weren't being felt as greatly in Brazil because of the shift in exchange rate. I'm not saying that the Brazilian real is going to lose another 53%. I don't think that's going to happen. I want to make that clear. But I do believe that there are going to be currency shifts in the next couple of years, and that's going to be playing a major role in the coffee market. As far as our outlook for India and Indonesia, we see a modest devaluation there. And the US, of course, probably getting stronger on their own economics and taper. And so if we take it all in, what are we saying at this moment? The market right now is rallying to $2, and the market is telling producers then to produce coffee because there's not enough coffee. And if we take that with respect to FX, we believe that the Brazilian real is going to weaken further in the next couple of years. And that means that this price, if we were theoretically to stay here, is only going to become more valuable in Brazilian reals, telling producers to produce even more. And then if we take a step back and look at demand for the last couple of years has been almost wholly focused on the Robusta side of the coffee market and a very small segment on the very high quality side. There is a massive amount of Arabica in the middle there that has been building stocks. And now we are rallying in New York, telling producers to produce more. And I think that this is a function of trying to ration demand and trying to figure out what the Brazilian crop is. But as we look forward, we think that there are potentially bearish scenarios if production can get back online. And with that in mind, the Brazilian shift vis-a-vis other shifts are potentially going to move production and trade globally in the coffee market.